A very Merry Christmas to you all. As I think of you, my loyal customers, sitting at home round your firesides this Christmas, it brings home to me very strongly the enormous responsibility that I have as your milkman. And I know that you will appreciate how important it is to me to know that I have your support and shall continue to have your support throughout the coming year. The task of supplying milk to a great nation such as ours is, I am sure you realize, not an easy one. Either here at home or in our colonies, spread as they are like butter over the entire globe. Whether home or colonial, it is our express wish that it be cooperative, uniting dairies across the world. The milk of human kindness must not be watered down. It must flow not only through the cream of society, but also onto the most humble doorstep in the land, be it black or white or gold top. Let our lives be ordered, and ordered as soon as possible, so as to avoid disappointment in the years to come. I extend my warmest and most heartfelt bottles to you all.
We present Lines from My Grandfather Christmas's Forehead, a sequential entertainment for Christmas, starring Ronnie Barker, also featuring Terence Brady and Pauline Yates, with Gordon Langford at the piano.
Silence in court!
Take the book in your right hand and read what it says on the card.
Christmas time is here again with mistletoe and holly. I wish you all you wish yourself and may your day be jolly.
The other side of the card.
Oh. I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Love, Dennis and Mabel.
Ah, oh, there you are, pretty girl.
Oh, hello, sir.
Enjoying the party, eh?
Oh, yes, sir, thank you very much. Enjoying myself? He must be joking. Who enjoys office parties?
I believe in an annual party, you know. I like to keep my staff happy at the festive season.
Very kind of you, sir. Pity you can't keep us happy for the rest of the year. Everyone's enjoying themselves, I think, sir.
Yeah, it seems to be going very well.
They're a miserable-looking lot when they're all in a bunch like this, huh?
Plenty to drink, Pettigrew.
Oh, yes, plenty, sir. He's bought that cut-price British-type sherry again. And how's your good lady, sir?
Awfully well, awfully well.
She's not here this evening.
No, as a matter of fact, she isn't. She had a bit of a head today.
Oh, what a shame. Bit of a head indeed. Socking great hangover, I should think. She drinks like a fish. Sorry to hear that.
Yes, so now if you'll excuse me, I must circulate. Have a jolly good Christmas. Help yourself to the sandwiches.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Hello, Mr. Kettigrew. Not a very swinging party, is it?
Hello, Sandra. Stick around, my dear, and I'll see if I can liven things up for you. I say, it's a very pretty dress, Sandra.
Oh, thanks, Mr. Pettigrew.
Blimey, the old goat's coming closer. He's going to breathe sherry fumes all over me.
Have another little drink, Sandra.
I've had three already.
Well, have another, my dear. Who's counting? Innocent little sherry can't harm you. Mind you, four might do the trick. Come on, it is Christmas.
All right, then. I'll have one more little drink.
At least his hands aren't all over me like old Fumbler Davis.
Darn.
Darling, Sandra, why don't we sit down over there?
In the corner, you mean?
Behind those filing cabinets, not on your sweet life.
Well, I was just going to powder my nose, Mr. Pettigrew.
Oh, were you?
Damn.
Oh, fine.
See you later.
Yeah.
Hello, Pettigrew. How's it going?
Oh, hello, Mr. Davis.
Where's little Sandra disappeared to?
I think she's gone home, Mr. Davis.
Oh, cheeky little minx, that one, eh? Yeah. Pity she's gone.
Yes. Dirty old devil, I know what he's after.
I hear you're joining my department after the Christmas holiday, Pettigrew.
Yes, yes, I'll be with you next week.
Well, don't forget, I want you to come straight to me with any problems or any suggestions.
Oh, yes, Mr. Davis. Yes, a fat lot of good that'll do me.
You see, I like to know what my staff are really thinking.
And I pride myself that I do know what they're thinking.
Oh. Oh, in that case, I beg your pardon.
What?
Oh, nothing. I mean, it's the sherry. It never did agree with me.
Yes, honesty and frankness. That's what business is all about, isn't it? Anyway, I look forward to having you in my department.
Heaven help me.
Well, I look forward to working with you, Mr. Davies.
Heaven help me.
Have a good Christmas, then, Pettigrew.
And you, Mr. Davies. And you.
I wonder if old Santa Claus will visit me again this Christmas as he has done in the past. The fellows at the office say he never visits men. He stops bringing his toys to boys as soon as they are 10. All I can say is I must be the last. I'm nearly 48 now, but I still hang up my sock beside the fireplace and my briefcase too. And every Christmas morning I awake at 6 o'clock to find my stocking bulging and my briefcase chock-a-block. So, as Mummy says, it really must be true. I've sent a list of things I want to Santa at the Pole, together with my usual Christmas greeting, but I've got a feeling this year he may strike me off his roll, because he can't get down our chimney now. There isn't any hole, since Daddy went and put in central heating.
I am a husband, wondering what to give my wife for Christmas. Last year I gave her a lovely pair of leather gauntlets, but they were a bit big for her, so now I wear them myself.
I'm a wife, trying to think what to give the old man for Christmas this year. I still haven't finished the scented talcum powder I gave him last year.
I'm a son, and it's always difficult to know what to give your parents. Unfortunately, neither of them ride a motorbike. I had to keep the crash helmet I bought last Christmas.
She won't want stockings again. I only hope she doesn't give me socks.
I might give him socks. And I could do with some stockings.
I wonder if our mum would like a few pairs of socks. All mine have got holes in.
I reckon she might like a new set of sparking plugs for the car.
I think he'd appreciate a set of electrically heated hair rollers.
I bet they'd be pleased with a football rattle.
Of course, it's daft to spend a lot of money. She'd probably be quite happy with a handkerchief.
What with everything so expensive? Perhaps I'll just get him a handkerchief.
I bet I'll finish up with a couple of handkerchiefs.
Motoring are not very nice. There's frost on the M1 and patches of ice. And also, I'm sorry, but in Cromwell Road, an articulated lorry has just shed its load. Oh, fog lights are flashing in Burton-on-Trent. There are hold-ups in Hull and there's chaos in Kent. In Slough there's a junction where things have gone wrong. As the traffic lights no longer function, there's a queue 5 miles long. It hurts me to add, but I feel you should know, the whole Isle of Wight's under 2 feet of snow. But if on your travels you happen to see a sleigh with a team of reindeer, don't hit it, it's me.
Ah, darling, our first Christmas in our own home. A little jolly old enough to know and enjoy it, eh? Where is he?
He's asleep. Better for him not to see it till the morning.
Yeah.
You got the lights, did you?
Yeah, yeah. They work too. Do you remember when we were kids, they never seemed to work, did they?
Yes. Never mattered, did it? Oh, Jim, I'm so happy.
So am I, darling. Right, let's start, shall we?
Yeah. Help me put the sheet down.
Yeah, there we are.
That's right. That'll catch the needles.
Yeah. Nice tree, isn't it, eh?
Mm.
There we are.
Oh, it's going to look lovely.
Right, well, you hold the bucket, darling, that's it. Now, we'll prop it up, see, with the logs, like that. Now, come on, darling, it's heavy. No, wait a minute. No, it's got a list. We don't want a crooked tree, do we? Now, wait a minute. That's it. That's better.
Jim, wouldn't it be better the other way round?
What do you mean?
Well, it's bushier at the back.
Oh, all right. There. How's that then?
Well, I don't know. I think it's better.
What do you mean, you think?
Oh, it is better, darling. Much better.
Right, well, we'd better have a go then. Hang on. Cling on to the ladder there. That's it.
Jim, do be careful with those decorations. Some of them belong to Mother.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
Oh, be careful what you're doing.
Oh, God. Oh.
It doesn't matter.
Well, it was only one of the old ones.
It did happen to belong to my mother.
Yeah, well, we've got lots more, love. Come on, pass them up. That's it. I put one there. That's it. Yeah. Oh, it's beginning to look lovely, isn't it? Right, now, pass the lights up, would you?
Here you are.
Don't need to bang together.
I'm trying my best.
Hold the ladder.
I've only got one pair of hands. Oh. I'm holding the tree steady.
Now, don't worry about the tree. Look, I'm perched up here 6 feet off the ground with a string of fairy. Hold the ladder.
I am holding the ladder, but there's only 8 stone of me and there's 14 stone of you.
Are you implying I should lose weight again?
I'm just implying that's a socking great bundle to hold up at the end of the ladder. Now, for heaven's sake, get a move on. I've got the stuffing to do.
How's that look?
Well, you haven't got them very high. They look silly there, like an electric belt round the knees.
Look, if you think I'm going to... Hold the ladder!
Oh, well, come down!
Oh, no. If you want them higher, I'll get them higher.
Oh, watch where you put your... That's another of Mother's.
I'll do this if it kills me. It was only another of your mother's tatty old angels anyway.
Oh, you never do anything right, do you? Look at the garage door.
Look, woman, just belt up. Do you hear me? Just belt up. We're decorating the tree. That's what you want, isn't it? Well, isn't it?
Oh, I'm going to do my stuffing.
Oh, well, go and get... Ow! Oh!
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore in Christ the Lord.
The bells are ringing, Bill. That's because it's Christmas Eve. But it ain't for you and me as they's a ringing. When we's cold and hungry, Bill, it's hard to make believe as we can hear the happy angels singing. If we'd a bed to sleep in and could get enough to eat, then bells and angels' voices might remind us. But not when we've to doss, Bill, in the cold and cruel street where the bobby's nearly always sure to find us. Dreadful hard on you, Bill, because you're such a little kid. What didn't oughta know a bit of sorrow? And wouldn't if them Christian folks as do as they was bid by him whose birthday's going to be tomorrow. But it was him what said, let little children come to me. I mean it, just such little cows as you, Bill. But I ain't got no chance, because I'm nearly 10, you see. And I tell you, as I knows a thing or two, Bill. Can't sell evening papers so's to get your bit to eat, like I done since the time I was 7. Without a picking up another badness in the street, to leave no earthly chance to get to heaven. Them coves what come around with tracks has summed me up a treat. I'm a outcast, little even, poor lost sinner. Perhaps they'd have been the same if they'd been brought up in the street and hardly ever had no proper dinner. But Bill, when you and me's dead, I'll come along with you and you shall introduce me as your brother. And him as knowed what sorrow was is sure to let me through. Cause why? We've been such pals to one another. Ain't we, Bill?
Thank you. George, do go and get ready. They'll be here soon.
Plenty of time, darling. Everything under control?
No, I can't get the cream to whip, and there's a very funny noise coming from the oven.
Really?
And I've just remembered that I've forgotten to wrap up your mother's present.
Never mind, Helen. It's the thought, not the wrapping paper.
And I do think you should turn up the central heating a bit more.
Darling, they're coming for dinner, not a sauna bath. Now, calm down.
George, it can't be them already.
Of course not. It's probably some inebriated postman who can't find the letterbox. Now, back to the kitchen and leave me to cope. All right, I'm coming.
Hello, Guff. British Rail. You Mr. George Hooker?
That's right.
Oh, good. Okay, Sydney, you can bring it out the van. Just sign this, would you, Guff?
Certainly. What exactly am I signing for?
Elephant, Guff.
I see.
Easy coming through the gate now, Sydney. You'll have that fixed down a minute.
It is an elephant.
Yes, they're immediately recognisable, aren't they? Yes. It's a size as much as anything. Shall we leave it in the garden, sir, or would you like brought in the house?
But there must be some mistake.
No, no, no mistake, sir, no. You are Mr. George Hooker, 43 Wellington Drive.
Well, yes.
Who is it, George?
Oh, what? Oh, it's all right, darling. It's nothing important. I'll be in a minute.
You hurry, it's freezing with the door open.
Yeah, right, darling. Now, look here, be reasonable. I mean, it's trampling all over my roses.
Oh, well, it's bound to want to stretch its legs a bit, isn't it? It's been cooped up in the van all the way from Tilbury Docks. Hello? What's happened to its sprig of mistletoe? Sydney? Where's that sprig of mistletoe? Has it eaten it?
I don't give a damn about its sprig of mistletoe.
You will if the mistletoe disagrees with it, Gov. Anyway, so, can get your shirt with me. I'm just delivering it, ain't I? Presumably it's a gift, is it?
Gift? From whom?
Oh, hang on a moment. Because it's got a seasonal message painted on the side of it. Sydney, tell it to turn round so the gent can see the seasonal message. Now, Sydney, you're talking to the wrong end. I wouldn't stand there if I was you. I mean, it's asking for it, innit?
Oh, for heaven's sake, mind the bird bath.
Mind the bird bath, Sydney. Now, hold it still so the gent can read the message.
Best wishes to all at number 43 from Uncle Bertram.
George, what are you doing out there?
No, nothing, nothing, darling. Look here, do you think we could get it into the summer house?
Oh, I don't know, Gov. We could try.
I'd be extremely grateful. Anything's better than having it tramping round the lawn. I mean, we've got people coming.
Yeah. Sydney, start turning it round the other way. We're putting it in the summer house. Well, try blowing in his ear hole then.
Heaven knows what I'm going to do with it.
George!
Oh, yes, I'm coming, darling, coming. I'm sorry about all that, darling.
George, I've just made the most ghastly discovery. I haven't got a present for Aunt Gladys.
Oh, dear.
I mean, we can't give everyone a present except her, can we? What am I to do, George?
Don't panic, Helen. No, I've got just the thing for Aunt Gladys. Get a ball of string and a very, very large piece of paper.
I am envisaging a lactescent Yuletide, bearing a strong similarity to those with which we were formerly acquainted in the past, at a time when the pinnacles of the arbors coruscated and the junior citizens eavesdropped in order that they might give audience to the reverberations of the sledge gongs in the slush. I am contemplating a particularly fleecy Noel. While in the process of putting my signature to each and every one of the seasonal pasteboards destined for my kith and kin, it is my sincere wish that your spans be Saturnalian and sanguine. And finally, may all your Hanukkahs be Caucasian.
Of course, Christmases aren't what they used to be.
No, not like the old days. Sparkling frost and snow over everything.
Yeah, like the old Christmas cards. Snow everywhere.
British Rail regret the late arrival of the 1320 from Manchester. This was due to frozen points and severe snowdrifts. The 1430 to Birmingham has been cancelled.
And what about the old-fashioned Christmas dinners, eh?
Yes. They knew how to eat in the old days.
Boar's heads, game pies, flagons of ale.
Goblets of wine. Why don't we eat like that nowadays?
But we're on a diet, you see. There's the soup. Well, I mean, that's 95 calories before you can say Santa Claus. Wine, well, that's 40 calories. Turkey in the trimming, say 140. Ham, 60. Christmas pudding, the 150. That's without the brandy butter, oh boy. I'm afraid we can't. But if you do have any yoghurt or wheat germ, perhaps, or perhaps even a nut or two.
And there were lots of carol singers in the old days.
Everywhere, all out in the street, singing their heads off.
I wonder why you don't hear so many of them nowadays.
No, you're right. Christmases aren't what they used to be.
Not quite like the old days.
Jesus Christ was born to save all you want and all you want to gain his everlasting hope. Christ was born to save. Christ was born to save.
One Christmas was so much like another in those years. Around the Seatown corner now, and out of all sound except the distant speaking of the voices I sometimes hear a moment before sleep, that I can never remember whether it snowed for 6 days and six nights when I was 12, or whether it snowed for 12 days and 12 nights when I was 6. Always on Christmas night there was music. An uncle played the fiddle, a cousin sang Cherry Ripe, and another uncle sang Drake's Drum. It was very warm in the little house. Aunt Hannah, who has got onto the parsnip wine, sang a song about bleeding hearts and death, and then another in which she said her heart was like a bird's nest. And then everybody laughed again, and then I went to bed. Looking through my bedroom window, out into the moonlight and the unending smoke-coloured snow, I could see the lights in the windows of all the other houses on our hill and hear the music rising from them. The long, steadily falling night. I turned the gas down. I got into bed. I said some words to the close and holy darkness. And then I slept.
You've been listening to Lines from My Grandfather Christmas's Forehead, starring Ronnie Barker, with Terence Brady, Pauline Yates, and Gordon Langford at the piano. The lines were written by Chris Allen, John Graham, W.W. Main and Leslie Harris, Michael Palin, Miles Rudge and Gordon Langford, Alan Scott and Chris Bryant, Dylan Thomas, and Gerald Wiley. The program was produced by John Fawcett Wilson.